blocking diet that it's a high. Let me begin by reminding you what an argument system is. An argument system is effectively a two-party protocol between a prover and a verifier, where the prover's objective is to convince the verifier that some NP statement X is true. For this talk, we're going to consider the NP language of Boolean circuit satisfiability. In a non-interactive argument system, the proof is a single message from the prover to the verifier. There are two main properties that we might care about when we consider non-interactive argument systems. For instance, completeness says that an honest prover should be able to convince an honest verifier that the statement is true. Soundness intuitively says that a computationally bounded prover should only be able to convince an honest verifier of a false statement with small probability. Concretely, in this talk, we're going to focus on the following definition of soundness, which says that a prover who is modeled by a Boolean circuit of size 2 to the lambda, where lambda is a concrete security parameter, should only be able to convince an honest verifier of a false statement with probability that is inverse exponential in a security parameter. By giving this concrete definition for soundness, we're able to perform comparisons between different constructions of argument systems. Next, we say that a non-interactive argument is succinct if, moreover, the arguments and the size of the proofs are very short. Namely, the length of a proof is polynomial in the security parameter and polylogarithmic in the size of the circuit. And in addition, the verifier's algorithm can also be implemented by a Boolean circuit whose size scales only polylogarithmically in the circuit size. In particular, the verifier complexity in a succinct non-interactive argument, or a SNARG system, can be significantly smaller than that of the classic NP verification algorithm. There are many such instantiations of succinct non-interactive arguments. For instance, Mikali's celebrated computationally sound, or CS proof, gives one such instantiation in a random oracle model. Alternatively, we can consider the common reference stream model, where we assume the existence of a trusted setup algorithm that generates a common reference stream here denoted sigma and a verification state tau. In a common reference stream model, the prover algorithm is now defined with respect to the common reference stream and the verification algorithm with respect to the verification state. We can consider many different variants of this model. For instance, in some cases, the verification state can be public, in which case we say this resulting argument system is publicly verifiable. Or in other cases, it could be secret, in which case we get designated verifier or secretly verifiable SNARGs. In this talk, we're going to focus primarily on building designated verifier SNARGs. In addition, sometimes we allow a pre-processing step that generates the common reference stream to run in time that is proportional to the size of the circuits that we're verifying. In this sense, the pre-processing algorithm is so-called expensive because it's proportional to the circuit size rather than polylogarithmic. In this case, we say the SNARG is a pre-processing SNARG. This will also be the focus of this talk. So having defined the notion of a succinct non-interactive argument system, there are several natural complexity notions that we might wonder about. For instance, if we want lambda bits of soundness, how short or how succinct can the proof be? Here, a trivial lower bound says that if I want lambda bits of soundness in a publicly verifiable setting, the proofs better be lambda bits, otherwise the prover cannot just guess a proof and succeed with some noticeable probability. It turns out that this even holds in the designated verifier setting, assuming that NP does not have succinct proofs. I'll refer you to the paper for the full details. It's a fairly straightforward argument. Next, another metric that we might be interested in is prover complexity. How much work does the prover have to invest in order to generate a proof of a true statement? Here, a simple lower bound is that the amount of work the prover has to do is proportional to the size of the circuit it's trying to generate a proof for. So having defined these two notions of complexity metrics by which we can measure the performance and efficiency of a SNARG, we can define a notion of a quasi-optimal SNARG, which is basically a SNARG that simultaneously minimizes both of these quantities. It simultaneously minimizes the proof length as well as the prover complexity, up to polylogarithmic factors. Concretely, it means the following two properties should hold. The proofs should be what we call quasi-optimally succinct. The length of a proof is only quasi-linear in the security parameter, and that is sufficient to achieve lambda bits of soundness. In addition, the amount of work that the prover should invest to generate a valid proof of a true statement should scale only quasi-linearly with the size of the circuit. There do allow for an additive term that grows polynomially in the security parameter and polylogarithmically with the circuit size, but the main factor that we care about is this quasi-linear scaling with the size of the circuit. Having defined these complexity notions, Let's look at some of the existing SNARG candidates. This is by no means an exhaustive list, but it should give you a sense for how the asymptotics of the different candidates we have. First, we have the CS proofs due to Micali. One of the first constructions of a succinct non-interactive argument, it turns out that with a suitable instantiation of a hash function, CS proofs can actually plausibly give us quasi-optimal prover complexity. And here, to simplify the comparison, I'm going to drop these low-order terms that depend only polylogarithmically in the circuit size. So with CS proofs, we can get a prover complexity that scales only quasi-linearly with the circuit size. However, CS proofs do not provide optimal succinctness. In order to provide lambda bits of soundness, the length of a CS proof grows quadratically in the security parameter. Alternatively, we can consider SNARG systems more that have been proposed more recently. These are due to concrete assumptions over bilinear maps or over lattice-based assumptions. All of these constructions actually provide quasi-optimal succinctness. Namely, to achieve lambda bits of soundness, the proofs in these candidate systems are only about lambda bits long. However, none of these systems, for reasons that I will soon describe, provide quasi-optimal prover complexity. Namely, the amount of work the prover has to invest to generate a proof as depends multiplicatively with the security parameter. And the main focus of this work is to actually build the first quasi-optimal succinct non-interactive argument system, namely an argument that simultaneously minimizes both the prover complexity as well as the proof size. So just to summarize, the main contribution of this work is we get a new framework for building pre-processing SNARGs. And this follows and extends upon the frameworks by Vitansky et al., as well as our own framework from earlier, from Eurocrypt of last year. Our framework, like all of the previous ones, follows in two main steps. First, we identify a suitable information theoretic primitive. In this case, it will be something called a linear multi-prover interactive proof, or a linear min. I will define this later on. And in this work, we give the first candidate construction of a quasi-optimal linear mean. Next, having defined this information theoretic primitive, we leverage a cryptographic tool to compile this linear mean into a pre-processing SNARG. This is the second ingredient of our compiler. And in this work, we show how to use leveraged cryptographic tools to go from linear means to pre-processing SNARGs. So combining these two primitives, a quasi-optimal linear mean and this linear-only vector encryption scheme, we can actually obtain the first quasi-optimal SNARG from a concrete cryptographic assumption, the existence of a linear-only vector encryption scheme. So the core building block in this our work is this new information theoretic primitive. And to introduce it, I need to go and define some preliminaries. So let me remind everyone what a linear PCP is. This was a notion first formalized and introduced in a work by Ishai, Kushilevitz, and Ostrowski. So in a linear PCP, it's very similar to a standard probabilistic checkable proof or a standard PCP, in that the verifier gets access to this proof oracle in the sky. In a traditional PCP model, the verifier gets to query bits of the PCP and then it needs to decide. In a linear PCP oracle, the proof can be viewed essentially as a vector. It implements a linear function. And the way that the verifier interacts with the linear PCP is it actually submits query vectors to the linear PCP oracle. And the oracle responses is going to be the inner product between the verifier's query vector and the linear PCP proof. The verifier can submit multiple queries to the linear PCP oracle, and at the end, it decides whether to accept or reject the proof. There are many concrete instantiations of the linear PCPs from different kinds of primitives, and such as the Walsh-Hadamard code or by the quadratic spam program of Gennaro et al. One of the most useful properties that these linear PCPs satisfy is that the verifier is actually oblivious. Namely, the queries that the verifier submits to the linear PCP oracle do not depend on a choice of a statement. It turns out that this is very useful for building SNARGs, as I will show next. The way it works is going to be as follows. Because the verifier's queries to the linear PCP do not depend on a statement that's being verified, what the verifier can actually do is generate these queries ahead of time and encrypt them and publish them as part of a common reference string. In this case, the verifier is going to use what's called a linear-only encryption scheme to encrypt its queries. Intuitively, a linear-only encryption scheme is an encryption scheme that's A, additively homomorphic, namely you can add and multiply ciphertext by scalars. And secondly, the only kinds of operations that is supported by a linear-only encryption scheme are these linear functions, computing, adding, and multiplying by scalars. So the way that we can now leverage this linear-only encryption scheme to build a SNARG from a linear PCP is as follows. The prover is going to come along, it has a statement and its witness, is going to generate from that a linear PCP encoding of the statement witness. And now it's simply going to implement or simulate the operation of the linear PCP oracle. It's going to pretend that the verifier actually submitted this query to the linear PCP oracle, and it's going to compute the inner product between its proof vector and each of the verifier's queries. It can do this because the underlying encryption scheme supports linear homomorphisms. This, in turn, is what is the SNARK proof. So if it turns out that the number of queries that the verifier has to make is constant, something that is satisfied by existing linear PCP instantiations, then what the proof contains, or the SNARK contains, is a constant number of ciphertexts. So if we use an encryption scheme that provides lambda bits of security, then the resulting SNARK proof consists of a constant number of ciphertexts, and therefore the length is linear in the security parameter. However, now let's consider the prover complexity. What the prover has to do is essentially evaluate all of these inner products between its proof vector and all of these encrypted query vectors. With existing linear PCP constructions, the length of the linear PCP is linear in the size of a circuit that's being checked. And if we the underlying additively homomorphic encryption scheme, or linear-only encryption scheme that we use, provides lambda bits of security, then each ciphertext is lambda bits long. And so the amount of work that the prover has to do is essentially lambda times the circuit size. Effectively, the prover overhead is multiplicative in the security parameter. Another way to look at this is essentially the following observation. We pay a cost of order lambda for every homomorphic operation we do, and if the number of homomorphic operations that we have to perform is proportional to the size of the circuit, then the overall prover complexity is not going to be, it's going to be suboptimal. It's going to be larger by this lambda factor. And so the way that we're going to overcome this barrier is we're going to look at a different kind of linear-only encryption scheme. Instead of encrypting a single field element at a time, we're instead going to encrypt a vector of field elements. Or if you prefer the more algebraic view, we're going to consider an encryption scheme where the underlying plaintext space is a polynomial ring that splits into a vector of field elements. As a picture, it looks like the following. Instead of encrypting one field element, we'll instead encrypt a vector of field elements. And now the homomorphic operations over this plaintext space really corresponds to addition and scalar multiplications of entire vector of field elements at a time. Now, the interesting thing is that we can actually instantiate these kinds of linear-only encryption schemes using encryption schemes based on a ring learning with errors assumption. And the nice property is the following. We can actually encrypt an entire vector containing lambda field elements in a single ciphertext that is also roughly order lambda bits long. Effectively, this means that when we perform these homomorphic operations over these packed ciphertexts or these encrypted vectors, we're only paying polylogarithmic overhead per every elementary field operation. This is what's going to allow us to achieve polylogarithmic overhead when it comes to the prover complexity. So graphically, what the state now looks like the following. When a verifier encrypts its queries, it can now encrypt an entire vector of queries within each ciphertext. And what the prover can now do is apply a different linear function to each of these queries. So somehow we've departed from the traditional linear PCP model, where the prover has to apply a consistent linear function, the same linear function, to all of these queries. Now it can operate on all of these slots independently. This is useful because it reduces the amortized complexity of these homomorphic operations, but at the same time it's now giving the prover more power. It's able to evaluate inconsistent and different linear functions in each of these different slots. So this suggests that we need to move away from the linear PCP model and look at something more general. And so the core information theoretic model, or primitive, that we're going to look at in this work is a notion called linear multi-prover interactive proof, or linear MIP, that was also introduced in the original work by Ishai et al. In a linear MIP model, instead of giving the verifier access to a single linear PCP oracle, we're instead going to give the verifier access to many independent linear functions, here denoted pi 1 up to pi l. The verifier is able to interact with all of these independent linear functions, and at the end, it decides whether to accept or reject. Now, the way that what we're going to show, I won't have time in this talk, but what we show in the paper, is that you can actually compile linear MIPs to pre-processing SNARKs using much of the same machinery, using linear-only encryption, where we encrypt vectors at a time rather than individual field elements. So now suppose, for sake of argument, that we had a linear MIP that has happened to satisfy the following properties. The number of proofs, so the total number of proofs here, is only order linear in a security parameter. And moreover, each of these proofs is essentially the size of the circuit that we want to verify divided by the total number of proofs. So the size, the proof is still going to be circuit size, but instead of giving one proof, we're instead going to chop this single proof up into L different proofs, each with size as the circuit size divided by L. And moreover, suppose the verifier only makes polylogarithmic many queries to all of these different proof oracles. Then we say that this resulting linear map is quasi-optimal. Why do I say that? Well, let's look at the complexity for the prover to respond to the verifier's queries. The prover complexity in this linear map setting is basically going to be proportional to the number of proofs times the side length of each proof, right? Because basically, on every query, the oracle is going to reply with the inner product between the proof and the query. And so if each query has size C over L, and we have L proofs, that means that the total amount of work that the prover has to do is roughly proportional or quasi-linear in the size of the circuit. And if we look at the total number of responses that is going to be computed, well, that's going to be proportional to the number of proofs times the number of queries, which is now quasi-linear in the security parameter. So in this work, the core focus is building a new quasi-optimal linear map, which then can be compiled and bootstrapped into a quasi-optimal preprocessing SNARG. To construct the quasi-optimal linear map, we rely on two core ingredients. First, we rely on what's called a robust circuit decomposition, which I will sketch in the next few slides, combined with a consistency check mechanism. And together, these two ingredients give us the first quasi-optimal linear map construction. So let me briefly describe for you what the robust decomposition primitive does. We're going to start as input, we're going to take as input a Boolean circuit of size S, the circuit that we want to verify. And what we're going to do is we're going to split it into many smaller circuits, or split it into many smaller constraint functions. So instead of checking satisfiability of the big circuit C, we're instead going to check satisfiability of each smaller constraint. Here we have L constraints, and we're going to assume that each of these constraints can actually be verified by a circuit of size S over L. Okay? So we've taken this circuit C and decompose it into many smaller subcircuits. Next, we take the original statement and witness for the big circuit C here, and we encode it into a statement and witness that will be used for each of these smaller constraint functions. Next, each of these constraints is going to read a small number of bits of the encoded statement and witness pair. Okay? And the properties that we want from a robust decomposition are as follows. First is the completeness requirement, which says that if we have a statement and witness that satisfies the original circuit, then the encoded statement and witness will satisfy all of these different constraints. Next, we have a robustness requirement, hence the name of robust decomposition, which says that if I have a false statement, if I have a statement that does not satisfy the Boolean circuit, then no matter what witness I use, only a constant fraction of these constraints can actually be satisfied, only a two-thirds fraction. And finally, there's an efficiency requirement, which is that the encoding function that takes the statement and witness for the large circuit and produces a statement and witness for these smaller constraint functions, this can actually be computed efficiently, namely in quasi-linear time. Okay, so why does this robust decomposition primitive help us in realizing a quasi-optimal SNARK or in building a quasi-optimal linear map? Well, for the following reason. What we're going to do is the following. We're going to take our statement C, or our circuit C, that we want to check satisfiability of. And instead of checking satisfiability of the big circuit, C, we're instead going to check that each of these smaller constraint functions are satisfiable. And the way that we're going to do that is we can actually just give a standard linear PCP proof of satisfiability for each of these constraint functions. In particular, using linear PCPs based on quadratic span programs, the size of each of these individual proofs is precisely equal to the size of the circuit C divided by the number of constraints we have, which in this case will be order security parameter. Each of these underlying proofs now provide 1 over polynomial soundness error. To check the proofs, what the verifier is going to do is it's going to check that all of these individual constraints are satisfied. So why does this new system provide completeness and soundness? For the following reasons. Completeness follows just by completeness of the decomposition and the underlying linear PCP instances that we use to argue satisfiability of each of these smaller constraints. Soundness follows for the following reason. Each of these individual linear PCPs provide polynomial soundness. So suppose we have a false statement, right? The robustness condition says that for a false statement, only a constant fraction of these constraints can be satisfied. And so if each of these linear PCP proofs actually provide polynomial soundness, and we have order security parameter number of proofs, then a constant fraction of them will actually fail. And so we actually get soundness amplification. The verifier will detect a false statement with a probability that is inverse exponential in the security parameter, or 1 minus that, 2 to the minus lambda. So this argument doesn't quite work, because for the following reason. Our robustness condition solely says that there's no consistent choice of witness that can simultaneously satisfy all of these different constraint functions. However, the malicious prover can cheat us by using a different witness when arguing satisfiability of each of these different constraints. And this can actually break soundness. So the second primitive that we need to make this argument go through is a consistency check mechanism. We need to somehow bind the prover to actually use a consistent set of witnesses in order to argue satisfiability of each of these smaller constraint functions. The way that we're going to do that is we're going to impose an additional property on the underlying linear PCPs, namely that they're systematic, namely that each of the linear PCP proofs actually contain a copy of the witness that was used to generate that proof. And so effectively, the way that we can view this is that each of the linear PCP proofs actually induces an assignment to the bits of a common witness. And a consistency check mechanism simply verifies that the prover uses consistent witnesses in order to construct all of these different linear PCP proofs. I won't have time to go into the details, I'll refer to the paper for that. So just to recap, the way that we build a quasi-optimal linear mean is we begin with a robust decomposition mechanism that takes a large circuit C that we want to check, and instead of checking satisfiability of the big circuit, we're instead going to check satisfiability of all of these different constraint functions. In the paper, we show how to instantiate this primitive using MPC in the head combined with a very efficient MPC protocol. I won't have time to go into the details there. The second ingredient we need is a consistency check mechanism that forces the prover to use a consistent set of witnesses in order to argue satisfiability of each of these smaller constraint functions. And together, we obtain a quasi-optimal linear mean. So just to wrap up, in this talk, we focused on the notion of quasi-optimality for succinct non-interactive arguments. And these are argument systems that simultaneously minimize the proof size as well as the prover complexity. We gave a new framework for building these quasi-optimal SNARGs by combining linear MIPS with linear-only vector encryption. And we gave a construction of a quasi-optimal linear MIP using its robust decomposition as well as a consistency check mechanism. In the paper, we also explore what happens when we push succinctness to the limit. What if we had a notion of a 1-bit SNARG that provides soundness 1/2? It turns out that such SNARGs actually have surprising connections and implies a weak form of witness encryption that suffices for numerous cryptographic applications. And this really highlights a connection between soundness and confidentiality. And there's an upcoming work by Berman et al. At Crypto this year, which also explores some of these similar types of connections. They start by using zero knowledge and show that it implies public key encryption. I encourage you to look at that paper for more details as well. And finally, let me give you a few open problems raised by our work. One problem, so all of the constructions I described in this work are in a designated verifier setting. So a natural challenge is trying to build publicly verifiable SNARGs that remain quasi-optimal. Perhaps the first step towards that is actually to realize what are called multi-theorem designated verifier SNARGs. So the constructions that I just described are only secure in a single theorem setting. It would be interesting if we can extend them to work in a multi-theorem setting. Another challenge is trying to get zero knowledge for these SNARGs without destroying the quasi-optimality of the underlying construction. Thank you very much.
Yes.
So in a robust decomposition, we take a large circuit C and we decompose it into order security parameter constraint
functions. Wouldn't it be more efficient? I don't know, it should actually be dependent on the circuit, on the size of the circuit. So it could be like a smaller number, a smaller decomposition.
Right, yeah, that's a good question. So when we actually compile from a linear to a preprocessing SNARG, we have to pack all of these different constraint functions into a single ciphertext. So if the number of constraints is now proportional to the size of the circuit, that means we have to encrypt a vector of length circuit size for each of our SNARGs. Of ciphertext in the CRS, and as a result, the length of each ciphertext is actually not succinct anymore. It's going to be proportional to circuit size.
You mentioned that the encryption scheme should be linearly this linear, so it means it shouldn't satisfy multiplicative form.
That's right. Yes. Yes. So linear only just says that the only kind of homomorphism supported by decryption are additive homomorphisms. And we can formalize it through the notion of an extractor. So there's an extractor that extracts a linear function that explains any adverse zero behavior on the
Okay, so now a few administrative announcements.